So good afternoon to all of you. Can I please ask you to mute your microphones during the presentation? So thank you for joining this sixth webinar that is being organized by ETSAP. I hope that it will be as interesting as the others. I'm sure it will. So we have two presenters in this one. We have Pernille and James, and the focus is on variable renewable energy modeling and especially variable renewable electricity generation in times models. So perhaps we can just move on directly into the presentations. Pernille will give the first presentation. She'll focus a bit more on stochastics and how this is being used within the Norwegian times model to model the variable renewable electricity generation. So Pernille, please go ahead.
Thank you, George. I will share my screen. So now I hope that you see my presentation in full presentation modus. So I will talk about stochastic modeling of variable renewable energy sources, and as George says, with focus on electricity generation. So just first, the motivation for stochastic programming. In real life, we make decisions based on the things are uncertain. For example, I never pack my backpack based on expected weather or a representative day. I pack my backpack such that I acknowledge that the weather can turn out to be quite a wide range of outcomes. So in real life, we make decisions based on uncertainty, but this is also relevant for energy system planning. And stochastic programming is a framework to incorporate uncertainty in optimization models. So first, I will present some theory behind stochastic programming and modeling of variable renewables before I will demonstrate how it's done in VEDA and in TIMES. So stochastic programming has been in a part of the TIMES code for many years now, and it is documented in this report that's available on the ETSAP webpage. And it's a stochastic programming, as I mentioned, I'll just remove, is a framework to explicitly consider uncertainty and to value flexibility in optimization models like times models. And in the low carbon energy transition with more intermittent renewables and a higher degree of electrification, there is more uncertainty related to ensuring that electricity supply meets electricity demand. And if we disregard this uncertainty, it can give misleading decision support. But this, of course, depends on the analysis we do and the methods we use. So this figure shows the wind production in two Danish regions, in Danish East and West, for a first week from 2008 to 2009. So what we see from this figure is that the wind production is highly uncertain. So variable renewable energy generation is highly uncertain and it's weather dependent. But we also see that there are correlations between the wind production in one region with the other region. There's also correlation in time, meaning what happens in the previous hour determines what will happen in the next hour. So in times models, we can use stochastic programming to model weather-dependent electricity generation. And we can design stochastic scenarios such that the correlations between regions and in time is ensured. So stochastic programming of variable renewable energy sources can be modeled by a two-stage stochastic model, where we have S discrete realization of the renewable electricity generation, depending on weather. We have uncertain parameters, DS, that has the probability of PS to occur, in this equation, we assume that all the scenarios have the same probability to occur, but that's not necessarily necessary. We also have fixed first stage decisions, meaning investments in capacity. That can be investments in wind, PV, hydropower. That's independent of the scenarios. And we have second stage decisions. That's optimal operation of the energy system given the realization of the renewable electricity generation. So for example, how should we operate the battery to given that the PV production was low or high or and so on. So that's stochastic programming objective function value is then the investment cost plus the expected operational cost over all the operational scenarios that can occur due to the uncertainty of the renewable production generation. So this is just an example to illustrate. So we have a model period here from 2015 to 2040. So the model gives one investment strategy for this period, but for each model period, we get as many operational strategies as there are stochastic scenarios. So there's a lot of literature that uses stochastic programming of variable renewable electricity generation in times models. And I will not go into detail on that here. But if you are interested, I recommend you to read further on this list. But what we learn from this literature is that a stochastic approach that acknowledged that the generation of renewables can have different outcomes compared to give different results than a deterministic approach that only has one operational scenario. And we see that just having one scenario or a deterministic approach often overestimate the value of intermittent renewables and underestimate the need for flexibility and capacity. And we also observe from the literature that not considering this uncertainty can give costly or infeasible energy system designs. This figure shows an example of a paper where we see how the deterministic investments for various scenarios give higher investments in wind power and hydropower compared to using a stochastic modeling approach. So this is an example where we see differences between the two modeling methodologies. So the first step to generate, do stochastic modeling, we need to make stochastic scenarios. So the first step is to make a database that represents the outcome of the uncertainty. So in this figure, you see the gray here is the outcome of PV production daily over winter, spring, summer, and fall based on hourly production data for 20 weather years. So the gray here is the database. But unfortunately, we cannot use all this data as input to our model. It will be a too heavy model. So we need to use the scenario generation method to select, make scenarios that represents this outcome of generation. So we use a specific scenario generation method. And then we select the use different numbers of scenarios as inputs to the times model. So here we have demonstrated three scenarios, the pink and the yellow and the blue, that is used as an input to represent the outcome of the PV production into the times model. But I just want to emphasize that often three scenarios is not enough to provide a solution of good quality, so this is more for illustration purposes. But what we see is that these three scenarios gives a different input compared to, for example, using the median of the databases or historical generation data. So as I mentioned, using few scenarios can give poor solutions, but we also see that the computational effort of using more scenarios increases with using more scenarios. So if we have a deterministic model with one scenario, it takes 2 minutes to run. If we have 15 scenarios, it takes 694 minutes. And 30 scenarios, it can take over 5,000 minutes. So that's about 4 days. So that's the dilemma. We want to use as many scenarios to give us a good representation of the uncertainty, but then also our computational effort increases. So now I'll move on to the VEDA demonstration. So this is the stochastic modeling parameters that's into the times code today. And when I model variable, renewable, and electricity generation, I use two of these parameters. And that's the stochastic commodity fraction parameter and the stochastic availability factors. And you should note that there are differences that some parameters are relative and some are absolute. So for the relative parameters, that requires that the corresponding deterministic parameter is also defined. This is an illustration of how we model PV, wind power, and run of the river in the Norwegian times model. We have, for example, wind power, we have existing capacity, but we also have new capacity that's split into different cost classes and different characteristics. And for these parameters, we have annual availability, and then the production profile of each of is given by the output commodity. And this is done to save equations and make a more simplified, less cumbersome model when because there is an option to put this profile into each technology, but we choose to do it in the commodity to reduce equations and parameters of our model. But when going into stochastics, we take the annual availability, that's the capacity factors of the technologies, and replace it with stochastic availability factors. And we take the commodity fractions, that's this production profile, and replace it with stochastic commodity fractions. So for example, if we have 15 stochastic scenarios, we would have 15 different wind production profiles. Okay, so I will try to show you how this is done in VEDA. So let me know if you don't see my VEDA model. So we go. The first thing we need to do is to define the scenario tree. And this is done by these parameters. So we assume the start year of the stochastic analysis, the number of scenarios we want to have, and the probability of each of these scenarios. So, and of course, you can have as many scenarios you want, and it doesn't matter how the probability is up to you what you want to assign each of these scenarios. And then we'll go into how I put the input data. And the first step for the input data is to overwrite the deterministic comp fraction, because this was a relative stochastic parameter. So the stochastic parameters is then multiplied with one. So this is just the first step to ensure that the stochastic comp fractions are the same, will be as you want. So the first step I do is to overwrite the commodity fractions of the deterministic modeling approach with one. That's just a modeling trick. And then I will show you the commodity fractions. So here is the stochastic commodity fraction of a given time slice of a given scenario 1, 2, and 3. So there you see that the commodity fraction is different for all of these stochastic scenarios, the three stochastic scenarios we have in this case. And the same is for the next time slice and for next time slice. So the sum of the commodity fractions equals one. So it just tells us when the production occurs, but it doesn't tell us if there is good wind years or poor wind years. Maybe I should describe that this is our regions and this is for the commodity electricity produced from wind. But to take into account that there can be good wind years and bad wind years, we use the stochastic annual availability factors. I can take for wind now too. No. Yeah. So we see that for region NO1, 1 year could have very good wind conditions, another year could have less good, and another year can have even poorer wind conditions. So this is the annual capacity factors, can varies from scenario to scenario. And then the next step to be able to run this, there is one thing we need to do before we're able to run the stochastic model after putting into the parameters. And that is by setting, I'm not sure if it's that clear for you, but this uncertainty equals fines. So we need to set uncertainty is fines to ensure that it's a stochastic modeling approach where investments are scenario independent and operationals are scenario dependent. And then I will show you some results. Because what's interesting is that I want to show you that the investments actually are scenario independent. So let's take all the wind power investments in our scenarios. Just wait, I'll take it there. So this is the wind power investments. And then what you see is that, I'm not sure how to make this bigger, but what you see is that the deterministic capacity that's here in a megawatt differs from the stochastic parameter capacity. But we also see that for each scenario, that's also called the state of the world, is the same. So it has scenario independent investments or scenario independent capacity. But we also see that it can give different results than the deterministic modeling approach. Second, I want to show you how it can give a different operational decisions. So let's see how it influences the use of a battery, for example. Sorted use of a battery, flow in, flow out in 2050. So that's what's the benefit of here is to get different strategies of the battery operation for each of the scenarios. So So here you see for the deterministic, this is for winter again, but for the deterministic modeling, you only get one inflow to the battery and one outflow strategy of the battery. But for the stochastic, you get three different inflows and outflows of the battery that depends on the realization on how much wind is produced, how much PV is produced, and how much hydropower is produced in each of these time slices. Okay. And then, so the battery operation I showed, it depends on the scenarios you have. And so we can give, because the scenarios capture more extreme variants, it can also, of course, then capture the need for storage in another way than the deterministic approach. So to conclude, implementing of stochastic variable renewables or renewable electricity generation is straightforward to do. Stochastic modeling of variable renewable energy sources can improve the quality of the decision support. However, this modeling requires that the use of the generation of stochastic scenarios are of good quality that provide a good solution. So you need to use some time to evaluate how to make appropriate stochastic scenarios. Also, the stochastic modeling approach increases the computational time. But you can always build your model in a deterministic manner and then just add a layer on with the stochastic modeling of variable renewables. So you don't need to have a high computational time with doing calibration of the model and so on. So that was it. Now we'll look forward to hear your comments.
Thanks, Pernille. So any comments, please raise your hand or just unmute and you can ask directly, Pernille. So there's one question, what's the ideal division of Norway into regions?
Okay, Norway is today consisting of five spot price regions. That have different electricity prices within these regions. So it reflects the bottlenecks and the market of the Norwegian electricity grid.
Great.
I can show you the, if somebody wants, I can show you also the model if something wasn't clear or too fast.
Perhaps you can. There's one question about how the hedging strategy before resolving uncertainty looks against the deterministic scenarios.
Yeah. We can in times include both stochastic modeling of short-term uncertainty, that's the weather-dependent renewable electricity generation, and for long-term uncertainty, what should I do given that, for example, we don't know the outcome of a policy today? I'm not sure that what you mean with the hedging strategy. But we can use both. I don't know of anyone who has succeeded doing it both in parallel, but it's available in the code. How looks hedging strategy? So this is not a typical, what I show now is not the typical hedging strategy because we just make a strategy acknowledging that the production can have different outcomes. I'm not sure if I was clear.
There's another question saying if you consider comparing your results to a soft linking strategy. Not yes. sure what that means. Yeah.
Yes, but it's always our modeling dilemma. Should we put the details into our models or should we build on interaction with other models? So it's interesting if you can achieve similar results by building on a power market model, that would be interesting. But I think the challenge with linking with power market models is you need a feedback on the investments too from the power market model. So that's what I think is a challenge, and I would look forward to if somebody did that in a nice way. Yeah.
Evangelos, you have raised your hand, so please speak up.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you, Pernille. A brilliant presentation, very nice. Excellent, I would say. I have a question because of the computational time. What strategy do you follow to select the scenarios? I mean, it's the most critical point. So do you have any heuristics how to navigate into this distribution and pick the probabilities? And yeah, my second point is with this model, why the computational time is exponential? So from 2 minutes, you go to 5,000 minutes with 30 scenarios. So I'm thinking how this can be applied to a bigger model that takes, let's say, an hour or so.
Yeah. So making good stochastic scenarios, it's a field on its own. But there are statistical methods you can use to evaluate the quality of your stochastic scenarios. Because from a computational time point of view, you want to use as few scenarios as possible, but that gives you a good solution. So you have, for example, you can use stability tests, but you can also, that requires that you test one model with many number of scenarios and to see how your model responds with the different number of scenarios or with different scenario generation methods. But there are several statistical methods you can use to evaluate the quality of your the results, including stability tests. But I can, And regarding computational power, that's our big struggle. Yeah. And yes.
Okay.
I'm happy if you can help me to solve this, Evangelos.
So there's one question from Paul. Maybe you can just read it, Pernille, and answer.
And how is the first, are the first stage decision being taken? Well, the first stage decisions are investments, and everything is done at optimization in times model. Everything is done at the same time. So it makes investment decisions given that it knows that the realization of the renewable generation can be different. So the first stage and second stage decisions, they can be misleading, but they are optimized at the same time in this case.
Great. So this was a question by Philip, actually, and there was one by Paul before that that he says that he thinks you assume the same availability factor in each future year on each branch of the tree. If you were varying AF on each branch in each time period, that better result than info storage?
Oh, yes. So you're wondering if I should change. This is this back and forward. Should you use the same scenarios in each model period or should you change? Is that what you, the availability factor, if it should differ from period to period? And that depends on the scenario generation method, but if it's partly random, it's possible. And I know that there are several teams that does this. And we have been back and forward on doing this. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Thanks a lot, Bernil. You're right on time, so that's fine. Thank you. So just as a reminder, we will also upload these presentations on ETSAP YouTube channel, so you can follow it up afterwards. So moving on to the second topic, the second presentation for today by James on, again, modeling high variable renewable energy generation, but then looking into hourly resolution and all the characteristics regarding the power sector operation in times like unit commitment, dispatch, and overall capacity expansion. So James, you can start.
Thanks, George. Can you hear me and see my screen okay?
Yeah, all clear.
Perfect, okay. Thanks, good morning to anybody west of Ireland and good evening to anybody east of Ireland. Just a few acknowledgements. First off, I just want to acknowledge my funders, the Science Foundation Ireland and the National Science Foundation China, who have been funding us for the last 3 years, developing the new Times Ireland model, and the Irish government and the Capacity Project funding the utilization of this model for policy scenarios and government insights. So the outline for the next 20 minutes or so is I'm going to talk a little bit about the hourly variations and fluctuations of variable renewable resources, so focusing on wind, solar, and hydro. I'm going to talk a bit about unit commitment constraints of the dispatchable power generation plants in the Irish energy system, and how would you implement that in your own times model. I'm going to talk a little bit about, or following on from what Pernille has already shown about the needs for system flexibility, to talk about demand flexibility and the need for storage to balance variable renewables. And hopefully I won't have to go too quickly. I'll do a demonstration just walking through the files within our Times Ireland model known as TIM, just so that you can use those same file structures in your own models. And I'll talk a little bit about the same headaches that we have around computer hardware and the best solver setup to get these large or relatively large sparse matrices to solve in GAMS. So just a little bit of background on why are we looking at variable renewable energy systems and modeling effectively a dispatch model in times. So there's many studies looking at 100% renewable energy systems, and we want to look at 100 or look at a zero carbon energy system in Ireland, and what are the optimal pathways for that in Ireland. Typically, somebody asked the question about why not soft link models, and we've done this before in Ireland and we've published on it. It's quite a highly published paper. These soft coupling or soft linking exercises, linking power systems models like Plexus to times. But there's issues with this around convergence, optimality. Pernille mentioned the feedback between investment cycles. There's so many things that aren't soft linked properly when you do the soft linking. So a hard coupled dispatch model in times is one possible way to go. So in this method, we model the power sector in Ireland in the new TIM. We show the new improved flexibility, both with flexible time resolution, flexible unit commitment resolution, and flexible spatial regional specifications in TIM. And the research question then is, what are the pathways for a power system that are consistent with 100% renewable energy system? And looking at the impacts of different numbers of time slices and the impact of unit commitment features. So minimum stable levels, ramp rates, heat rates, cycling costs, startup costs, all those, the good stuff from the power system side of modeling. So what does the reference energy system for the power sector in TIM look like? It looks a little bit like this. So we have the primary energy commodities that are available to the power sector in the Times Ireland model. So we've got our fossil fuels, our bioenergy, both indigenous and import potentials, and our variable renewable resources. I'm just realizing you can't see my mouse. So we have then the next stage, we have all the different power plants, so the different processes in our models, sort of coal plants down to bioenergy power plants, and then the variable renewable plants. So we have wind, solar, ocean is made up of wave and tidal. We have then final energy production, so centralized electricity. We then have electrolysis generation to produce hydrogen. various types of hydrogen that's produced. These can then go into different loops, so we can have hydrogen storage, or we can have hydrogen equipped power plants that again generates electricity. And then there's storage again in the form of hydrogen, and energy storage in the form of pumped hydro. And then we have our final electricity demands endogenously coming from the times energy system model. So I'll go on to that now, the next step. So typically we in the times model we have we represent our time slices in usually seasonal resolution, with a day, a night, an evening, and a peak type resolution. So over here on the right hand side we've typical time slice resolution, and each of these bar charts is representing the percentage of energy of the annual energy consumed per time slice. And this is how we would generally specify our time slice resolution. In developing TIM, we've done different specifications, going from 576 time slices representing 12 months, a weekday, a weekend, and a 24-hour resolution. I'm going to present hourly work in a minute. And we're bringing in historical hourly demand data, historical hourly wind and solar data, and historically hourly wave and tidal data based on ocean buoys off the coast of Ireland. So we're going from this type of specification to something more like this. So we have hourly resolution and chronology in there. Regards the technical specification then, and what we're trying to include, the new dispatch features that we're including in our model. So we're modeling at the individual unit level in the model. So we have the individual turbines in each power plant in Ireland in the base year are modeled. And we're utilizing the unit commitment features that are documented, and the documentation is available at that link. So instead of the typical availability factor and capacities that we would normally use for power plant generation, we're including all the dispatch functionality that's available in the time source code. So we've startup costs, startup time, efficiency losses during cold startup. So we've got cold, warm, and hot startups, minimum stable levels, the efficiency curve, so the efficiency losses at minimum stable level, and how the efficiency of a power plant changes as it ramps up, the ramp up rates, the ramp down rates, etc. You can see all the different features that we're including here. We've also dug in a bit into the spatial resolution in Times Ireland. So we know, based on various social and technical resource potentials, where the wind blows heavily in Ireland and where there's a good potential, good resource, but we equally know where all the houses are, we know where all the existing substations are. And so we mapped the potential technical resource and then the distance from each of those resources to the substations where they could be connected. So we've got nearly over 1900 different land parcels where we expect the wind resource to go, and then we developed a supply curve for each of those locations depending on the distance to the nearest substation and what it would cost to connect to that substation. So getting on to more onto the topic of this presentation then, so we're trying to incorporate variable renewable power generation. Ireland has a very large wind energy potential. On average, annually, we produce 40% of our electricity now from wind. But as you can see, if you're looking at the year 2018, over the months from January through the summer, June to December, for the week numbers 1, 13, 26, and 52, the wind potential varies hugely over the year. So we need to be able to balance this level of variability. And by assuming flat operation or much less volatile variation, we miss the real dynamics and constraints going on in the power system. So as I said, we've incorporated all these dispatch functions in times, and we now get in times Ireland, we now model at the turbine level each different coal-powered turbine in Ireland, each gas power turbine, and all the wind farms and the hydro plants within the power system. And then this is within the power system, then coupled, I should say, into the whole energy system as well. Okay, so we typically see that the need for unit commitment and the need for modeling at the turbine level, all the dispatch and dispatch functionality and capacity expansion that's needed. We consider dispatch from the ground, from the bottom up of the merit order, from coal at the bottom ramping up to wind and variable renewable to the top. But of course, with zero marginal cost, the merit order has been flipped on its head, and that it's the variable renewables are what is dominating our merit order and what gets onto the grid first. So we're now having to have coal plants in Ireland and gas plants match what's going on an hourly basis with wind. And so we see various dynamics when we have very low wind, for example, on this Tuesday in January 2018, that we're having all the dispatchable power come on, and we have hydro storage coming in to meet to balance out the grid and balance the demand. The other thing that's very nice about this in times is that we have full capacity expansion going from the base year in 2018, going at an hourly resolution out to 2050 in these results. So we get hourly dispatch for every period in the model, and we have all the dispatch and ramping constraints balancing. So you can see when there's high ramps of wind, then we have bioenergy ramping down to match with demand, or that in periods with high wind and low demand, we get the hydrogen generation coming in, or hydrogen storage coming in and being consumed in electricity generation when there's low wind. And so to the last point before I go on to the demonstration of why this is so important. When we look at our power system model, how we normally model it with 16 time slices, we can see the electricity production and the fuel mix in each time slice. So from an autumn day, an autumn evening, summer day, summer evening, etc. to the wind, we can see the different fuel mixes that are coming through. We will have a little bit of coal. So this is for 2050. For with ocean, we have solar, we have a lot of wind coming through. But we don't pick up any of the needs for hydrogen or for battery storage in this when we model it at this kind of resolution. When we model it at much higher hourly resolution, we pick up the needs for energy storage and energy storage and flexibility. So we see in periods when we've got a lot of wind on the grid generating, we don't need all that wind, but what we do then is produce hydrogen, and then this hydrogen is used later on when there's less wind on the grid, and we can use the hydrogen that's created here later on in during the summer when there's low wind to keep the grid balanced and to keep the lights on. So we see when we have low time slice and without unit commitment, we don't have any real need for energy storage or hydrogen storage in how we model in times models. But when we have higher time slice resolution and when we have higher time slice resolution with unit commitment, we start to see storage and flexibility needs increasing in the model to make the model feasible, which without that level of flexibility and that level of storage, you would presume that the model is infeasible. So I'm going to move on briefly then to a quick demonstration of each of these files that you need to put into your model to enable this type of functionality. So I'm just going to go through how we've set up hourly time slice definitions, the hourly availability factors for different renewable potentials, the hourly commodity fractions. Again, Pernil already showed a bit of this, but I'll just go through it a little bit again. We have hourly commodity fractions for power, and we recently started introducing it for transport, and we're hoping to introduce it for residential dynamics in the next few weeks. I'll show a general unit commitment setup and very briefly just show some how to export these results to Tableau. And then maybe in the questions, we can talk a little bit about the computer hardware requirements and any solver setups that, that help you solve these larger models more computationally efficiently. So I'm just going to come out of PowerPoint here for a minute. So if I go to our Times Ireland model, everybody who's familiar with VEDA 2 should will know that this is what it looks like. We have our base year scenarios here. So we have agriculture, industry, power, residential, services, supply.
James, we cannot see the screen, sorry.
Oh, okay. Sorry, George, is it very small or you just can't see it?
No, no, you're not sharing the screen.
Okay, apologies. You can see it now?
Yeah, now we can see it. Good.
Okay, thanks, George. So we have, as we're saying, we have our base year templates here. We have our suppress, our technology databases in the middle, and we have our different scenario files that we might need. So starting off with our system settings, we normally have our regional definitions, and we have defined our time slices like this. This is probably a bit small, so I'll just zoom in a bit. So our time slices are defined at the seasonal level for each month, so we have 12 months. At the weekly level, we have 31 days. And at the day-night level, we have 24 hours. Then when we put everything else in a scenario file that we call, what is it? It's here, subannual data. So this means that we can jump around between different time slice resolutions from 40 time slices to hourly to sub-hourly if we want. So within this scenario file, this the system set the sorry not system settings, the subannual scenario file, we define the year fraction, so the amount of time that each of these time slices represents, which is the same. It's 1 divided by 8,760 for each different time slice. And then we have this regional flexibility in our model. So we have the national version of the model, or we have county level version of the model, so the time slices are the same. And then we define, again, for the same time slice level. So we have month one, day one, hour one, month one, day one, hour two, etc. We define the commodity fractions for each of the commodities that we need. So we're defining the commodity fraction for electricity production to be to follow the annual or the historical low profile. So this is representing the fraction in that hour of the total energy demand for electricity historically in 2018. And then that low profile is used each year and each period thereafter. So I'll look at wind. So we similarly, we specify the availability factor at each hour. So month one, day one, hour zero, midnight on January, 1 a.m. on January 1st, etc. For each wind technology, so every technology in the power sector in a model starts with P, then anything that contains wind and onshore, it has an availability factor at midnight on January 1st of 41%, 43%, etc. And we do the same for offshore wind. Again, the availability factors are slightly different historically. And similarly, we continue this type of process based on historical data for wave energy, for tidal energy, and look at solar. So obviously during the night, there's no solar energy potential in Ireland, and there's low solar energy potential in January in Ireland, and it gets much better during the summer. So that's the availability factors that you would need. And we can similarly do these for transport demands, or as Prina said, you can do it on a technology basis as well. It's far more efficient computationally to do it on commodities than on processes. The next thing then is specifying each of the different unit commitment specific or functions. So again, we just have this in a scenario file called power unit commitment, which we have here. And so we're specifying these on a generalized basis. So each technology that's a CCGT power plant that consumes gas, depending on whether they're hot, warm, or cold, they'll have different startup costs, which you can see here. There'll be different efficiency losses, again, for thermal power plants, from hot, warm, and cold. There'll be different shutdown times based, again, on each different thermal power plant that's available, again, specifying it on hot, warm, and cold, etc. The other thing I'll say is that our model is on GitHub and should be openly accessible in the next few months, ideally in the next 2 months. So this will be available to download for anybody who wants to use it. I'm nearly out of time, so I'm just going to move on to the last few files. So we then specify our base year is specifying for each different turbine in the current power plant, the current power system. So we again similarly specify in our base year template each different turbine, their different units, and similarly their efficiencies, their availability factors. And then each of these different power plants have the same unit commitment functions that are specified in that other scenario file. So those four files, so the system settings, setting up all the availability factors, the unit commitment. Well, actually those three files would pretty much do it. And the base year template is just specifying details on the current power plant stock. So if I go back then to my slides, I'll skip the results for now for Tableau. The one thing I'll say that this does add quite a bit computationally to solve. Our team generally takes about two minutes to solve, less than 1 gigabyte of RAM generally. When we start to solve it at an hourly resolution, it can go up into the hundreds of gigabytes if you try to solve it with perfect foresight. Solving it myopically making sure that we calibrate reducing the amount of resolution the commodities are tracked on can reduce it down to about 32 gigabytes of RAM to solve. That's one of the key things. So making sure that you're only tracking commodities at the level that you, at the time slice level that you really need, and solving it myopically really makes a massive difference in whether or not it's solvable on a normal laptop with about 32 gigs of RAM. So just a few final insights. Writing an hourly times model to RAM can take a considerable amount of time, and it almost takes as long to write it to the RAM than it does to actually solve, which is something I need to figure out whether I'm doing something wrong to speed that up. As I said, running it myopically really helps to make the model solvable and tractable within a normal computer hardware. You can solve it in a solver or a server, but you're going to run into the hundreds of gigabytes of RAM needed to do it. And then some final just modeling insights. We find that impact of changing the temporal resolution from 16 time slices to hourly 576 time slices, the generation mix can change. It's a 10% difference between dispatch and variable renewables, depending on what time slices you have. But there's big impacts on the need for energy storage. I'll leave that there for now. Thanks, George. I'm a little bit over time there. Sorry about that.
Thanks, James. So, open for questions. Don't see any hands for any reason. So just to reply on a general question, all this material will be available on the ETSAP website as presentations, and all the the live presentations will be available on the ETSAP YouTube channel, so you can watch them again and you can download the presentations. There's one question on the interconnected flows. How are the interconnected flows modeled?
So for now, we have basically capacities. So the actual capacities of the interconnectors to the UK are represented, but they're represented by the average seasonal cost for electricity. And there's a margin between the average cost of importing electricity. So there's basically, it's cheaper to generate electricity on average in Ireland than it is to import it. But in periods then when electricity generation is very expensive, it'll import it. We haven't modeled the UK or France at an early resolution yet. We could do, but it's basically driven on the capacity to import and the a price differential assumption based on what the cost of electricity is in the UK or in France.
And continue to that, what direction do they flow in high wind days?
On high wind days, they generally export.
Mm-hmm. So regarding that, the profile of the cost for imports, you assume sort of a standard cost and profile based on historical data, or?
Yeah, it's pretty flat. It's just the seasonal, the seasonal historical average price. And if average price for electricity, so if it goes above that average price for electricity generation, it'll export it. And if it's below it, it'll import it, if it needs to import it.
How many years of hourly load data is required as inputs for times?
So we just have 1 year. We're just taking 2018 and using that load profile. The shape of the profile is the same each year, but the demand grows. So there's a normalized commodity fraction over the year that stays the same, and the actual demand for energy over each year grows in proportion to economic activity. That's another area for uncertainty analysis, that demand shape will change. We're exploring how that will change with vehicle to grid, whether you can take the trough out in the middle of the night with EV charging, with electric vehicle charging, can we move around the peaks in power gen? That's something that we're exploring at the moment.
And can you see the messages on chats, but I don't read them all?
I don't. If I stop sharing my screen, I think I will.
Okay, yeah, maybe it's better. So there's one from Philip.
So great, James. Thank you. Can we have a times model with a dummy region for electricity production? More substances and define this region load. Whoa, okay. So to Philip, I think yes. I'm not sure why though. So to have a separate region modeling your electricity with a higher time slice resolution. I'm not sure what that would do to your default regions and why, how that would make sense.
Exactly, this is what I'm thinking. Have a region dummy, a dummy region with inputs of gas, coal, or whatever, supply of wind, load profiles, and then there may be required a time slice aggregator in order to transfer the supply from the dummy region to a one or two or whatever regions of your main model is structured.
Right now, I don't think it's possible to have different regions,
number of regions
in your model running at different time slice resolutions. You can couple up to 3 times models together. I've never done it, but I know it's possible. I'm a little bit confused as to why that would be useful. If you've got your main region, your main model is at a lower time slice resolution than your dummy model.
Benefit would be that the user can define the profile, the reload profile.
Sure, but you can, sorry, okay, now I understand. You can use the historical low profile and aggregate it automatically already. So there's one of the previous ETSAP projects has a code and a tool that you can take historical hourly time series and aggregate those low profiles and VRES availability factors to whatever the time slice resolution is in your model. If that's useful for you.
Great.
Yeah, Pranil's asking a question. There's a project that's just about to start with myself, with Evangelos in PSI, Anti in VTT, and Amit in Canoras in India, we will be making time slice resolution specific to regions and specific to year periods, which means, I mean, the rationale for it was that you could zoom in and out of temporal resolution over different time periods so that we could have high resolution in the short term and lower temporal resolution in the long term. But as Pranil correctly says that in the chat, that we will have that index including on a regional basis. So possibly we could have hourly resolution in one region and less resolution in another region.
But this is not available yet, right?
No, we haven't started that work yet. It should be available by the end of the year.
Okay. Great. And then there's another question in chat.
I see a comment. It's not really a question.
Yeah, so that's a comment.
Thanks.
It's a pat on the back. So thanks.
Mr. O'Sullivan or Ms. O'Sullivan.
Good. Okay. So thanks a lot, James.
Thanks, George.
And thank you, Pranil, for the presentation. Thank you all for participating in this webinar as well. So this is the scheduling that we have for the upcoming webinars until June. You can find it on the ETSAP website. So Evangelos, perhaps you can give a bit of a teaser for the next one that is planned for April.
The only teaser that I can give is that I didn't get confirmations yet from the... Okay. And since Pernille is also, it was also Pernille in my invitation list, I don't know. I will send again a reminder, but I wanted also to discuss with you, George, because it can be that we do it combined with the TCP storage. So let's have a talk on that, and maybe we shift it on Optimum. Let's see.
Okay. So,
we have 5 minutes later, we can. Thanks.
Good. Thanks. So, we'll see how this goes for storage, and then we have one planned for May, where we will try to have a webinar together with the ICMIP and the Clean to Power project. So, look into the incorporation of climate variations, fluctuations, and extremes on energy systems models. And then moving back to June, we'll have one for resilient services modeling in times. So it's still flexible, as you see this agenda. So we try to see what kind of topics are interesting, and we'll try to accommodate more webinars in the future. So if you have any topics you would like to see, please do send me a message, and we'll try to set up a webinar in the future. So. Thanks again. Thank you all for participating. Thanks, Paul, for organizing this. And As soon as we decide on the date for the next webinar, an invitation will be circulated to the whole of the mailing list of ETSAP. So thank you all. Goodbye.